I hope you're ready.
The original Fantasy Island ran for 7 seasons and 2 made-for-TV movies between 1977 and 1984, and starred Khan Noonien Singh as the enigmatic overseer Mr. Rourke and Knick-Knack as his diminutive assistant Tattoo. Every Saturday night at 10 o'clock Eastern Standard Time, right after The Love Boat, viewers could tune into ABC and follow an assorted cast of celebrity guest stars for 48 minutes as they explored the titular island, living out their myriad fantasies and oftentimes getting in over their heads, but rarely without gaining valuable insight into themselves, their lives, or the lives of those around them. The fantasies ran the gamut from the innocuous to the extreme, from dreams of fame and love to desires of both hunting and being hunted by killers. It was a much beloved series and honestly way wilder than I initially recalled. I mean, I was a child when it was on.
Oh, stop. Think of the children.
Director Jeff Wadlow has yet to helm a single movie I've enjoyed. Never Back Down is insipid. Kick-Ass 2 doesn't do anything that wasn't already done better in Kick-Ass 1. And Truth or Dare was so mind-numbingly stupid it made me want to resort to acts of malicious mayhem. So when I saw the trailer for this updated version of the late 70s, early 80s TV classic, I kinda just went, huh. And then I saw his name attached to it, and the fleeting sliver of interest I had expressed died inside me before I'd even had time to register its existence. In Wadlow's defense, despite a preview emblazoned with Blumhouse Studio logos and imagery overtly leaning hard into the Saw-style trappings of the torture horror genre, the movie really doesn't stray too far from the show. It's certainly bloodier, making this one only the second scariest adaptation of a television series behind Chips.
Cool.
The Fantasy Island of yesteryear was no stranger to concepts like ghosts, time travel, and even immortality, as the original Mr. Rourke was often alluded to being several hundreds of years old at least. Yeah, it's a much odder show than most of us remember. Screenwriters Gillian Jacobs and Christopher Roach of the aforementioned god-awful Truth or Dare and the mostly fine 2014 Liam Neeson distraction Non-Stop, respectively, provide writing services alongside Wadlow himself for this endeavor, which introduces us to an unassuming group of contest winners with their sights set on experiencing their heart's deepest desires. Among them are Blumhouse alum Lucy Hale, who comes to the island seeking revenge on her grade school tormentor, Mr. Robot's Portia Doubleday. Whiplash's Austin Stowell plays a police officer who wants to live out his dream of being a soldier. Ryan Hansen and Jimmy O. Young of Like a Boss, is it in their contracts that they have to star together in everything from now on? Play brothers who've come to the island because they want it all, which basically amounts to lots of sex, drugs, and alcohol. And Live Free or Die Hard's Maggie Q seeks an opportunity to finally accept a marriage proposal she refused 5 years ago. To their credit, Hansen and Young have a sincerely fun dynamic, these brothers who are so loving and supportive of one another. Of the little bit of heart the film has, they provide nearly all of it. Maggie Q's storyline also starts off strongly, even if it sadly doesn't end that way. It's one of lost love and more so how we are too often capable of hurting ourselves more than others ever could. Mr. Rourke is played by the criminally miscast Michael Peña of Ant-Man and End of Watch. Unlike the charismatic Ricardo Montalban, Peña's Rourke is kinda creepy from the off, at times coming off as too busy or easily irritated to deal with these people and their ridiculous shenanigans. He staffs the island with a zombie-like crew of creepers, one of whom just shows up in a guest bedroom while they're sleeping, and at no point does it ever feel like he's not up to something. There's also this guy who keeps showing up named Dr. Torture, who I could not take seriously to save my life, because every time he appeared, I kept hearing,
"Reptile."
Oh, and if that's not weird enough, Michael Rooker's in it. And no spoilers, but he gets involved in a moment I can only kinda describe as, well, being like... Mr. Rourke's rules for this fantasy island are much the same as they were on the television show. Your fantasy may not play out exactly the way you expect it will, but whatever that fantasy might be, you have to see it through to its conclusion, which is all fine and good in theory, but gets dicey with a quickness once people start killing one another. I might as well go ahead and say it. This movie has a host of problems. Can I first say that I'd like to impose a 10-year moratorium on jump scares? The film relies almost solely on them for its frights to the point where you're completely burned out by the third instance. The acting across the board isn't great, nor is the dialogue. I dare say Maggie Q is the only one who comes out of this with her dignity intact. It gets embarrassing watching these people deliver the lines they've been given, many of which seem designed specifically to induce groans, eye rolls, or a combination of both. It also feels like the production schedule for this might have been too tight, as the screenplay feels both rushed and incomplete. There's a storyline with a cartel that feels as though it came from a different, unrelated film Jacobs and Roach were working on prior to this that didn't get made, so it was lifted out of that and dropped here. The whole thing has a rewrites cost money so we won't be doing any of those flavor to it, as it writes itself into a corner more times than I can count, and rectifies the dilemma not by resolving the issue, but by compounding it with another, newer dilemma. It manages to straddle a bizarre line, at once feeling like both a first draft and a mishmash of every draft, as though no single idea conjured during the writing process was rejected or cut, or run by anyone, or workshopped, or focus grouped, or really even just thought about. The rules the film plays by are never made clear, so by the end it becomes impossible to tell who's doing what to whom else or really why. Is Rourke doing it? Is the island doing it? Are the guests doing it? Is it ghosts? It's both everything and nothing. The film is at least entertaining, more than once reminding me of last year's escape room, and I'm comfortable saying that it sticks the landing when it comes to the massive third act reveal. But by far the biggest misstep is that it isn't satisfied with said reveal, because it then proceeds to have four more of them, each more implausible than the last, until the entire ordeal grows so convoluted you give up trying to play along and just want it to end. Composer extraordinaire Bear McCreary of Battlestar Galactica and The Walking Dead provides a score that, frankly, sounds like it belongs in a different film. And that isn't easy for me to say, I'm a big fan. There's a pretty solid movie in here somewhere, I swear there is, but I fear it required more time than anyone involved was given to uncover it. I won't say I didn't enjoy it, but the decision to keep trying to surprise the audience again and again with a series of exponentially more unbelievable twists and turns feels less like the writers thinking themselves clever and more like them wanting to use all of the alternate endings meant for the Blu-ray at once. Any one of them probably would have done the job, but it becomes gluttonous in its need to keep you guessing. I hope there are no plans for a sequel, as this one leaves little left to explore, but I fear you and I both know a world where this movie doesn't come back to haunt us is the real fantasy. Hey guys, thanks for tuning in. If you enjoyed today's episode, hit that subscribe button, leave a comment, and give us a like. Ring that bell so you never miss an update, and follow Tangent1985 on Twitter for more. I'm M. Glenn Gore, and I'll see you next time.